Right. Welcome, and I'm delighted to see so many people here in the University of Chicago, which has traditionally had an interest in two kinds of linguistics, particularly language change and conduct linguistics. And I must say that I think our subject, the Chinese language, is particularly rich in well-documented evidence on both these subjects. And when studying any subject, I think it's useful to identify what one is talking about. You see, some people, in their being postmodern, try to explain it away, but I think it is very useful to identify precisely the sources that one has. And today we will do little else. We will be looking at the 3,300 years of sources that are actually on this Macintosh computer. And that are extraordinarily rich and almost frustratingly accessible through digitization. And so what we want to do is first reflect a little bit at a distance on why historical linguistics, why the history of syntax, why the history of the vocabulary and so on. And my intuition is that you never understand a culture much better than you do understand the sources you have on it. These sources are studied by a discipline called philology, and within philology, the core discipline is and remains linguistics. And in that sense, then, I'm a believer in philology, and within this field of philology, I am a strong believer in logically based linguistics. So my primary interest in Chinese is actually in asking the question, what can we learn about the logical scaffolding of human language from a language that is as different as Chinese? So what would happen to analytical philosophy, for example, if their insights weren't all based on English? What would happen also to general linguistics if their practitioners were not so largely concentrating on the analysis of languages that are interpreted into English, read into English, and sometimes even almost read as if it was English? We would like to study then this philology as well as linguistics. So the linguistics is a tool within the hermeneutics of cultures for me. And so I'm not a pure scientist here, you know, I'm unclean. I love to have dirty philological hands, if you see what I mean. I love to be find myself talking about examples much more than about abstract theories. So we will have a class here which will be almost frustratingly much dominated by a close logical consideration of examples rather than a factual abstract presentation of the principles of Chinese grammar. We will get to this systematic part in the last part of this course. So linguistics and philology are thus fundamental and indispensable for all areas of the humanities as far as we are concerned. And I'm not interested that people don't believe us. I think this is objectively true. And history is never going to be much better history than the understanding of historical sources is. And that understanding of historical sources is going to depend on us as philologists. Literature, even more so. What kind of literary understanding is there that does not base itself on the adequate hermeneutics, systematic understanding and interpretation of primary sources. So, you know, I know nobody is believing us, but I think we should maintain the truth even when nobody wants to know about it, and when, in fact, in many parts of our scientific academic universe, philology has become something of a negatively laden term. It is through linguistics and philology that we can try to understand different civilizations or cultures on their own conceptual terms. And that is the reason why I'm doing linguistics. I want to understand cultures on their own terms. Thus, translations interest me much less than the diagnosing of the failure of translations, the diagnosing of the untranslatables, the diagnosing of the uniqueness of conceptual schemes in different cultures. So that is the scheme. And for many centuries, China then has been among those cultures which have become objects unto themselves. The Chinese found themselves fascinating and wrote a huge number of books about their own history, the 24 or 26 dynastic histories, but also about their own characters, the first huge dictionary, 100 AD, by the grace of God, exactly 100 AD, so we never forget when it was. And we have a unique tradition of dictionaries in Chinese from about that time. And above all, we have a long tradition of phonological theory, and that tradition is about 600 years older in China than it is in the West. That is a chastening reflection. The first phonological theorizings in China occurred around 601 AD. And it is very clear that they were not just interested in sounds, but in phonological systems at a very early stage. That, of course, does not now concern us in the context of grammar, but I think it's a nice background to have. We have a special animal here, Chinese culture. So, what then are our primary sources? They are written and oral. For modern times, they are oral and should be. And I am convinced that linguistics would be a more interesting subject if it weren't always concerned with dead bodies on the written page. If the sentences we discussed were not what's on the page, but what occurs with intonation, prosody, and context. And it's quite surprising that you can, without distorting things too much, speak of a kind of linguistic necrophilia. It is as if linguists love decontextualized sentences as such. But I must speak like Jesus Christ and say, but I tell you, sentences as such occur only in dictionaries and grammars and so on. Otherwise, sentences as such never occur. Therefore, it's very curious that they should be the object of linguistic theorizing. I think this is worth reflecting on. This, what I would call linguistic necrophilia, is dangerous because John loves Mary is very different whether you say John loves Mary, John loves Mary, John loves Mary. The logic and the structure is totally different, and they would be syntactically totally different in classical Chinese. So there's nothing basically the same here. basically they're very different, and the facts of classical Chinese, when you translate these different intonations, prove it. So it is not true that intonation adds a few nuances here and there. So when we talk about modern Chinese, we never talk about modern Chinese without its intonation and its prosody, yu diao, as well as sheng diao. So not only the tones, but also the prosodic features, including, by the way, very much speed. So I give you a very small example. When we discuss Haoxiang, apparently, or something, in English, right? Quite difficult to translate. But of course, the way it's realized in Chinese is normally, see, and we're interested, you see? The speed is of the essence, and this word is not like, very similar, you see? Then you can see that our dictionaries of modern Chinese are a tragedy, miserable, because they pretend that the word haoxiang exists in Chinese. There's no such thing. There's only haoxiang, and this very current, reduced form, at least in northern Chinese, so that's on the written and the spoken, and we have among the written two fascinatingly different things. The, if you like, edited and probably doctored and probably corrected printed material, of which we should be suspicious in many cases, especially when it's when we're speaking of our old sources. You have that? It's quite a there is good reason to be suspicious of texts that have undergone an editorial process that normalized them. Well, in fact, we are the linguists who exactly are interested in the pre-normalized practice. As it were, the object of that the editors are normalizing. We would like to see that. For the modern period, this course can be in itself, we can base ourselves on extensive oral material, which we can visualize Prat style. And if you like, we can go into this in quite some detail, because we have a 2,000-hour database of such material concerning an idiolect of Peking Manchu Chinese. And there you can then see that all our evidence is living, spontaneous speech, 2,000 hours of it, and always with its context, always with its intonation. So then, for the modern period, we have that, and we have the Mandarin Audio Idiolect Dictionary, which I will present to you at a later stage. And we are proud to have it, because, for example, it would be almost useless to have a large corpus of read-out material. What we are interested in is the spontaneous production of language, and not the pa-tian pa-di de nian-chu, right? The kind of reading out which is afraid, you know, of being incorrect. We would like, in fact, spontaneous speech that is not afraid of itself. So, for modern material, we will essentially avoid this linguistic necrophilia. And we will regard as our primary evidence not at all the quotations that we see in general linguistics, but the snippets the communicative acts of linguistic activity, of linguistic practice. And they, of course, give us a type of access to modern Chinese studies of linguistics that we don't have for classical. Although, inspired by this modern work, we can actually reconstruct quite a few features of classical prosody, as we will see. So then, what are our sources? We start out with the oracle bone inscriptions, probably even before 1200, but 1200 to 950 BC, we have those inscriptions, 50,000 of them substantial, and 100,000 of them may be consulted in Thesaurus Linguae Sericae under the URL that you see there, accessible to translation and systematic analysis on the one hand, lexical analysis and grammatical analysis, and in particular to a systematic way of interpreting this evidence, which is the oldest we have from China, in the context of later developments of the language. So that's what we want to do. We analyze these oracle bone inscriptions from 1200 BC on exactly the same principles as we analyze modern Chinese. And we then see what happens. And we shall see that a lot of things happen in these 3,000 years. The fun is that Thesaurus Linguae Sericae, TLS, makes all these things searchably available and makes it possible to consult the inscriptions that have been translated and to provide a systematic survey of the grammatical phenomena of the oracle bone language. And here I've already made a judgment which is wrong. Language is not what you would use for what we have here, because you only have a very limited code used on bones for a very limited set of things. So it's a little bit like East Slavonic. You see, codes. They are codes. Diplomatic Slavonic, you see, is also a code, you see. Lots of things can't be said in it. Church Slavonic, in a book that I have read 40 years ago, was explained to me, by the way, also by Professor Umbegaun, as, in fact, not so much a language, but a limited code for a specific purpose. So to say that our oracle bones are the earliest stage of classical Chinese is to grossly distort things. It is the earliest kind of evidence we have of writing in Chinese, and it clearly links up to linguistic practices and probably, very probably, writes only words that existed. But we have no clear vision of how this limited code writing relates to spoken practice. We only think that the elements will come from the language. What they wrote were words, but how they combined them and how many they would write, that would be have to be remain an open question to ask. Yes?
What degree of phonetic or phonological information can we even extrapolate from the oracle bone inscriptions?
Quite a lot. And in fact, there are those of us who think we can even propose a phonology for oracle bone inscription Chinese. Starostin would come close to such a view. Others like myself think that we have here an interesting case where the practitioners of this reconstruction have a vested interest in exaggerating the possibilities for success. And therefore, you see, I am personally a great deal more doubtful than the specialists in reconstruction. I think we probably have good reason to think that certain features can be plausibly reconstructed for that phonology, but we are very far from actually being able to make a complete reconstruction. Yeah.
Because as I understand, and this is sort of a shallow understanding, so if I'm wrong, please let me know, the oracle bone inscriptions are largely pictographic?
Well, not so largely, you know. In fact, perhaps we shouldn't go too deeply now into questions of characters. What we do want to stress is already the oracle bone inscriptions are very heavily phonetic, and the phonetic aspect of loaning one character for another and so on, one character for a word that really is not the pictographically designated thing is very common in Jagu and in the oracle bone inscriptions. So it's a pity you weren't there last term where we would be discussing such issues. So there we go. We have the grammar by Zhang Yujin, a study of the study of the grammar of oracle bone inscriptions. This is a 600-page work, if I remember correctly. You will be amazed by the wealth of grammatical detail it provides. But like all Chinese grammars that I know of, at the highest level of scholarship, Zhang Yujin regards it as something of a disgrace to translate his examples. But of course, most of the examples that he quotes would have at least six different and competing and plausible translation versions for us. And therefore, his grammar is immensely useful in providing details of things to interpret, but they leave a lot uninterpreted and unexplained. But this is the best we have. And Zhang Yujin has the kind of status of a handbook, and this is what I will base my generalizations on when it comes to this. Also, Zhang Yujin has a very nice survey of oracle bone grammar studies, you see, which explains in great detail everybody else's views on this. So it's quite a useful, he's a very fine point de départ for our studies. It has to be said that when it comes to the history of Chinese syntax and the historical study of the Chinese language, there is only one center for doing this subject professionally, and that is in Paris, at the Centre National de Recherche Scientifique, CNRS. And here, under the leadership of Alain Perob, a large number of people are doing nothing other than historical study of East Asian linguistics. So that is the only center that I know of where, you know, more than half a dozen, nearly a dozen professors are professionally concerned with this area. So it's very important to realize that the center for the study of historical linguistics is in Paris and nowhere else in the West, as far as I see. So that is the work of Redouane Djamouri, Études des formes syntaxiques dans les écrits gravés sur les cahiers de tortue. And now that work has an immense advantage. Its author, by the way, is Arab, comes from Algeria, and his mother tongue is Arabic, and he has a wonderful command of Manchu, and is also very interested in modern dialects, by the way, of the northern dialects of Gansu and so on. And he has given us this book, which has the strength that I was missing in Zhang Yujin. Namely, he carefully commits himself to a translation of every example that he quotes. And therefore, this book is, to my mind, the thing that you should be looking at if you want to get an impression of ancient oracle bone grammar systematically presented in detail. If you want the survey, then Kryukov, Yazyk Inskikh Napisey, 1973, remains the only survey in any Western language. And as we shall see, Russia is in fact the country that has, and the Russian language has, the most detailed empirical studies of historical syntax in the Western world. Outside of China, it is the Russians who have this school of historical linguistics in St. Petersburg under the direction of Dragunov, Lungov Wu, and his incredibly talented disciple, Sergei Yakhontov. And Sergei Yakhontov is our hero, and he wrote a fantastic survey of classical Chinese grammar, and is a really foxed linguist, if ever there was one. And I'm very pleased to report that Sergei Yakhontov has given us, for our thesaurus linguae sericae, all his record cards of grammatical observations. He has made a special photocopy for our project. I'm deeply grateful to him. He is indeed, I think, quite universally recognized as the leading practitioner of historical grammar in the West. And he has a large set of students, all of whom are wonderful ladies, and who have written, all of whom, according to the principles defined by Sergei Yakhontov, historical grammars of different stages of the Chinese language. I won't go into too much detail about it. I have them all, and I'd be delighted to share them with you. So that is the language of the Yin inscriptions. This is a small book, and I think you may be able to find in your library here an English version of it. I have it. I don't know whether it was published formally, but I have, there is an English version of this book by Kryukov, and it's quite, and if you like, I can give you a PDF of this little thing. Yes?
Do you have a chalk site for this seminar?
Not yet. Should be chalk one, yes, and then put it there and people can download it. So anyway, I do have a PDF of this English version of Kryukov's book. So this, you must now imagine, is a cottage industry of linguistic research in China. A very large number of people have been writing just on the grammar of the oracle bone inscriptions. I'm giving you here the kind of way in, and I'm by no means giving you remotely a 50th of the books and articles that are written about it. So that's the next thing then are our bronze inscriptions. 1200 to 300 BC, their special features are that they are written onto bronze implements and also bronze swords, knives, pots, and pans. Some of which are even called pan. Sorry, irrelevant remark. So, 14,000 inscriptions survive, and all these are available, some with translation, for analysis in our TLS. So if you're interested in these inscriptions, you find all the evidence on TLS searchable. And you can then, we are indeed, working on the systematic analysis of the bronze inscriptions in the context of later developments of Chinese grammar. So we always like to think of our efforts as having a dynamic relation to modern linguistic phenomena in China. So we like to see the past as being in a dynamic relation to the present, and not as a pure matter of archaeology, if you see what I mean. Guan Xiechu studies in the Western Zhou bronze inscriptions. That is a fat book, also 600 pages. And if at some stage some of you get seriously interested, all these I can show you, and we can go over them at our ease. But at this point, I just want to introduce the existence. So here you have Guan Xiechu in 1981, basically providing for us a solid descriptive grammar of the bronze inscriptions. And the tragedy is that he translates none of his examples, and bronze inscriptions are notoriously inscrutable and very much disputed with respect to their meaning and interpretation. And that limits the interest of the thing. You see what I mean? Because you constantly wonder what the insiders would have to say about each sentence quoted. It's not an easy language to follow. And therefore, we are incredibly grateful to Dobson from Toronto, whose early archaic Chinese provides exactly that. He actually worked with the Chinese, Wu Shuchang, Xianchang, if I remember correctly. And he provides careful translations of all his example sentences and gives us actually a very solid, beautiful transcription and translation and a take on the grammatical interpretation and analysis of that language. So that is early archaic Chinese on the bronze inscriptions. The next thing is our excavated literature on bamboo and silk. So far, we've only talked about excavated material, right? We are not looking at edited things so far, right? We are looking at the real thing, unedited. These are the unedited, excavated writings. We have them from around 400, probably a little before BC, to 1000 AD in TLS, where you can look them up. And in fact, nearly all of those that are pre-200 BC, you can look up actually. With translation, draft. And we do have for that a grammar of Warring States excavated literature from Chu. A terrific grammar which shares this feature that it will not translate its example sentences. And that means that for many of us, like myself, you see, I often have to choose between 7 possible readings, you see, and wonder which one the grammarian here, you know, thought was relevant to his observations and his analysis. And that's one of the tragedies, I think, one of the features that irritate one in the long run, that the wealth of material that is provided by Chinese historians of their own language so rarely includes commitment to a certain translation, reading, interpretation of the sentences analyzed. You see, that is not so necessary in other languages, but when material is as difficult as this and as controversial as this, then I think there's good reason to hope that when we write about it, we always make sure that we commit ourselves to a reading. And of course, to my mind, a grammatical analysis of a sentence is always already a grammatical analysis of a sentence under a given interpretation, and never of the sentence as such, if you see what I mean. Because most sentences admit of variant readings. And in fact, that is very much true of the sentences that Chomsky quotes, you see. He just hopes that you have the intonation that he thought was the intonation for the sentence or something. So there we go. There is another study, an MA thesis, which I could pass on to people, a grammatical study of the grammar of the Baoshan bamboo slips, quite early. These are very interesting primary evidence. Yes?
Are most of these sources available in simplified and traditional, or
are they also translations? This one is, I believe, from Taiwan, so it will be a problem for you. most of the sources that I could put up on such a chalk site would be in simplified characters.
Okay.
Yeah. But of course, as soon as somebody is D'Elio, then he will write Fan Tinzhen. Because it is very irritating that every time you quote a Chinese sentence, you will be misquoting it with Dian Tizi, because there are Gang Gao Yu and Fang Guai Yu, and so on. You have these different characters that are written, that are collapsed into one simplified character, and that is very humiliating for a linguist, because the two words are not the same. You see? So we would like to be precise, and so there's a risk that if something is really very good, then it's likely that it will be in complex, real,
traditional
characters. Right. So there we go. We then have, again, a completely different genre, the pre-classical songs now. These are the texts for songs and dance. They come from around 950 to 600 BC, and they are all translated in TLS, and therefore very conveniently studied by all of you, if you feel like it. And the language of the Book of Songs has been studied in wonderful detail by Dobson. I think that is his best book, actually, the language of the Book of Songs. Unfortunately, I don't think anybody has a PDF of it. But that is a very useful book. Now, please note that here again, when you have the language of songs, that is not the language of the 10th to the 7th century BC. That is a literary conventional idiom for poetry. It differs hugely from what you would expect to have been colloquial Chinese of the time. It's very much as you have it in Latin, and what you see in Horace or in Ovid is not what you expect to hear in Plautus, in the comedies of the time, you see, which gives you colloquial Chinese. So it's a very different kettle of fish, And lots of phenomena are found to be common in poetry and quite radically absent in prose. And then, of course, totally inappropriate in comic dialogue and so on. So I hope you can see, this is quite an experience we've seen before. You have all these codes. You see, what you might write down on bronze, what you might write down on oracle bones, you see, and then what you might put into a ritual song to which one would dance. All these things, you can see, are limited codes. They are not stages of the language, you see. So in this, at this early stage, we have a great problem identifying with any confidence what we would call a natural language spoken at that stage. We have no access to it. We have only this access to epiphenomenal codes. Hmm? That's to say, they are epiphenomena on the body linguistic. Hmm? They are not the body linguistic itself. That body is inaccessible to us. And so there we are. Then come historical, pre-classical, historical speeches and annals and the like, dating very roughly the earliest possibly from 900, even earlier than that, the latest possibly even later than 300 BC. All of these beautifully available in TLS for your study. And we have a very interesting Dianti, it's a simplified character study by Tian Zongwu, who ran a huge project on the Shangshu, the book of documents that I'm talking about here. And he wrote really a very satisfying descriptive grammar of that book. Can you see, when we talk about Chinese linguistic history, grammatical history, we really have splendid sources to base ourselves on, both when it comes to primary sources because they are digitized, but also, God, you know, really, when it comes to secondary sources, like this very fine grammar by Tian Zongwu. And then we have classical prose and poetry from 500 BC or thereabouts onwards. And there we begin to have something that would represent something close to colloquial Chinese of the time. So when Confucius talks in the Analects, then we have highly stylized, very controlled, rhetorically shaped, and worked on colloquial Chinese. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But what about the speeches and annals? They were, in your view, they did not really represent spoken.
Well, for example, the Zhou Zhuan commentary falls under this, right? It's not annals, but the later narrative commentary. But the Chunqu annals, the annals themselves, you see, I think, are of the code type, very limited. See, and in fact, nobody has wanted to write very much of a grammar of the Chunqu annals, because they are also very simple and predictable. And they are, in a sense, not alive. If there's any text that ever was alive in Chinese literary history, it is the Analects. And every time you read it again, you can see that it is vibrant. You know, it is vibrant with colloquial strength. So it is a delight to read. And anyone who wants to get into the hang of classical Chinese in its living form would go to the Analects. I personally have written about the Analects, trying to show that it's actually pre-Confucian. It's full of things that shouldn't be there and that poke fun at Confucius, and in particular where Confucius pokes fun at himself, and it's really not at all in the tradition of Confucianism. So it has an unrestrained form. It's a unique document, really, the Analects of Confucius. And they are one of the earliest pieces of such living prose. Whereas before you have speechifying, which doesn't quite give you the same sense of colloquial aliveness. And why I think that, indeed, you know, one has a nose for it, you know, you never find it quite alive. Perhaps I'm biased against these earlier speeches, but they seem to me to be rigid in a way that doesn't correspond to the liveliness of dialogue and mutuality of discourse that you have in the Confucian Analects. Yes?
In these sort of, I guess, more not as lively or not as indicative of natural speech documents, do we see any sort of features that are retained in them that we see in texts pre and post the Baihua movement?
Yes, yes. You would speak, you see, and then you would be deliberately archaizing, you see, and you would, in that way, have a kind of intertextuality in early China already, yes, you see, even Confucius and so on, you know, you raise your style, and of course, through quotation, Confucius would quote semi-erotic passages from the from the Book of Songs and so on, you see, which is quite interesting. Later Confucians would not have chosen just those, if you see what I mean. So you can see it is lively in that sense. It is unruly.
So there are similarities in these documents compared to what we see after the Baihua movement.
Yes, and I think, for example, that as we now go on through our stuff here, we will see that there's a feature of Chinese that is pervasive, and that is the jicheng xing, the tremendous failure of the Chinese tradition to forget. So there's somehow, you know, from the Shangshu, the Book of Documents onwards, you know, these things were remembered, and these things could pop up. And the Chinese language then has retained its history, you see, selectively, of course, but has retained. And this jicheng xing is not self-evident. For example, modern English retains very little Chaucer, literally, you know, and so on. And in German, you know, I can think of very little Middle High German that survives in modern German. The only language in which this happens to the same, in the same way as in Chinese, is in Arabic. For example, I'm told that in Italian it's not happening.
Not in modern Greek.
In modern Greek, I haven't asked anybody, but in, for example, in Hindi, it's not happening. You cannot quote little bits of Sanskrit in Hindi. It's just not on.
Oh.
Very curiously, not on. And I believe also in Greek, it's not on.
Yeah.
You know, you don't sort of have a little bit of Plato or something. No. It's not on. So it's very interesting. In the case of Greek, then, of course, you have the different varieties of Greek. And in some written varieties of Greek, you very much have this jicheng xing. But in spoken Greek, I believe you don't. So let's go here, and we have most of the early and many of the later sources, down to 1000 AD, are searchable and presented in TLS, which I will show you how to use. So you can then follow my story as I interpret the history of Chinese grammar in great detail and find the counterexamples. The reason why it's so good to have these texts and these analyses online, ready for analysis, is that you need translated texts in which you can find counter evidence to the irresponsible generalizations of old Christoph, you see, or anybody who tells you something about Chinese grammar. It makes life very dangerous that you have all this evidence, you see, where you can really look for counter evidence to any generalization. So it is quite hard now to 乱七八糟的说这样那样，不行，他就是自己慢慢， you see, it is all very difficult. So let us then have a look. Yang Bojun and He Leshi, who, by the way, collaborated with TLS over decades, they have written The Grammar of Ancient Chinese and Its Development, 古汉语语法及其发展. That is the best book to look for comprehensive information. And you can see the outline of classical Chinese grammar by Pulip Lang is indeed a meager outline, and in fact it represents the failure of English language publications to produce even a bad reference grammar of Chinese, classical Chinese. We don't have it. What we I have a book, Aspects of Classical Chinese Syntax, which I can give to everybody. In Kyoto, they stole it and made a beautiful PDF of it, so now I can distribute it. as a matter of interest, there is a 3-volume grammar of classical Chinese in Dutch, by Mully, which is a very fine thing if you read Dutch, and even if you don't, it's actually a very useful survey in 3 volumes, and there is an 8-volume grammar by my very dear friend Ulrich Unger in German. And so, yes, there are these things, but not in English. And you can see that for this kind of descriptive linguistics, English is not necessarily this particularly salubrious language to have as one's working tool. On the contrary, I think that in this instance, probably we can use this as an example where a German scholarship for philology remains quite useful in many contexts. So then we have a new development, and that new development is, remember, I said Confucius would give us, the dialogues of Confucius would give us an idea of a highly polished and stylized colloquial Chinese of the time. What happened was that this idiom became a written medium that was impervious to linguistic development. So that even by the time of Sima Jian in the 1st century BC, it was noted that we write very differently from how we speak. And that distance became greater and greater, and everybody wrote still in the obligatory mode of the Zhuo Zhuan, and Mengzi, and so on, so that you can sometimes even be in doubt, you know, whether something is 5th century or 4th century BC or 2nd century AD, you know. They simply continued to aspire to the same style, but the language did change, and how do we get hold of this language change? Well, by the same mechanism that caused Martin Luther to write his translation of the Bible in the style of popular speech. right? And he made a theory about it even. Über das Dolmetschen. Very interesting. On translation. And what we have in Christianity then, and what we have in Martin Luther, is that the religious interest in communicating with the semi-literate, who were not used to reading elevated literature, but had a need to read their own spoken language, right? To that need, Luther catered, and thereby created, you know, very much, had a great influence on the standard of modern German. And what happened here is that the Buddhists had exactly the same desire. They wanted to write their stories in such a way that not only the intellectuals, but also the Guangda Qingzhong could follow. Does that make sense? And that is why we have splendid colloquial Chinese literature only in Buddhist contexts to begin with, or very predominantly in Buddhist contexts to begin with. And these contexts that we have are contexts where a Buddhist tale which should lead you to Buddhist salvation needed to be made accessible, to the Guangda Qingzhong. And so we have from the 3rd century to the 10th century the colloquial texts in Buddhist stories. And I'm really proud that a fairly large selection of these are accessible with translation and extensive annotation, among others by Christoph Andel, who is a specialist in Zen Buddhist Chinese, and who has made a tremendous effort in the TLS to analyze in great detail the grammar of vernacular or colloquial Chinese as used by the Zen Buddhists in these texts. That is a subculture. It was completely unrespectable. It wouldn't be like that in the newspapers or something, you see. This is a subculture where the Zen Buddhists actually were not only colloquial, but they loved to be objectionably vernacular and use dirty words if they could think of them, and so on. So the Zen Buddhist texts are really quite outrageous, if you see what I mean. They love to provoke. Can you see what I mean? Zen Buddhist texts are a joy for the linguist who would like to see the creativity that is brought to bear on the language system. You see, the freshness of use of language in the in these Buddhist texts is amazing. And Christoph Andel of the University of Ghent has made a very substantial contribution for all of us. And I myself have worked in lesser detail on a text which is the first great joke collection of the Buddhists. So the title should have been Entering Nirvana with a Smile, because all these texts are jokes that are supposed to lead you to Buddhist salvation there and then.
Are these koans? I'm sorry, are these koans?
No, they are just jokes. Okay. Want a good joke like that? Shall I just give you one joke that I really like very much? You see, this guy comes in, you know, and is offered something to eat by his host, you see, and he finds it, may work. So he complains, and the guest, you know, the host goes out and gets some salt, puts some salt on, you know, and brings it in again, you know, and then the guest tastes it. He says, This is now perfect. How come it's so perfect? He said, well, I put salt. And the guest swore, I will never eat anything other than salt. You see? And the sense of the story, of course, is that the condiment salt is not what you should live on, you see? And Buddhism is also like the condiment to life, you see? It maketh all the difference, but I think it's a very nice story, and I found in this collection, you know, much joy and richness of experience. Mm. Beautiful. 100 tales. It's called the Bai Yu Jing. And it is, by the way, studied in terrific detail by Isabella Gurievich, I think, Gurievich, in an exhaustive grammar on the Bai Yu Jing. And so I have been able to work on this together with the student of Sergei Yakhontov, which was a great pleasure and honor. So you can see, that is the Buddhist colloquial text. By the way, these tend to be, and very often in any case are, dated very precisely. So you know, for example, the Bai Yu Jing, I believe, is 467 or something. So we know exactly when it was written, and so on. Here is Isabella Gurievich, A Survey of the Grammar, Очерк китайской грамматики, from 1972. That is a classic. And it has had a great influence on the study of early colloquial Chinese. Now, this is colloquial and not vernacular, no dirty words. It's not excessively vernacular. You will see that we have later sources that do give us access to the street language, very precious access. So, as you can see, now here we have complete tales written in colloquial Chinese, but, and here comes your phenomenon, with this Ji Cheng Xing. When appropriate, they would revert to classical phrases and so on, right? So very much like Martin Luther, who, when drinking his beer and discussing life over his meals, would easily break into Latin for a phrase or two. That's exactly what happens here. Very comparable. We know about Martin Luther's table talk because we have three fat volumes of that table talk collected by all those who met him. So we know exactly his Ji Cheng Xing, you know, his failure to be purely faithful to his policy of using informal modern terms. He had this failure of interest. Sometimes he felt it was more natural to use.
Yes.
So, I'm sorry to keep harping on this business with Luther, but I find the comparison really useful because if you are interested in Martin Luther, you can read up on him, you see, and then you will have basically the story of what happened in China also. It's very complex. And in addition, we have this Chrestomathia по истории китайского языка from the 3rd to the 15th century. Beautiful thing. And that book, which I also have a PDF if people want it. It gives you a wonderful survey of the colloquial literature of this time in its variety. And then, of course, it also gives you sources where the Chinese non-Buddhists took a page out of the Buddhist book and began to write themselves in colloquial Chinese increasingly and so on. So I think, again, we have nothing of the sort in English. And it's, I think, chastening. I think it's good to remind oneself of the fact, you know, that other Western countries have taken a much greater or more careful interest in this wealth, which I hope you are getting a sense for, this tremendous wealth of historical documentation we have. So these Buddhist colloquial texts are a subculture, but that subculture spilled over into a non-subcultural Chinese creativity in terms of short stories and novels through the ages. I hope you find that. So then, that is what we have, colloquial narrative and table talk.
Christopher, yes? One question about those yes? colloquial texts again. They're local creations, they're not translations from Pali, right? They're not Jatakas or anything.
Many of them are Jatakas, others are not. So the percentage is probably 50-50. For example, my Bai Yujing, people have tried to find antecedents and often have found them. So this Buddhist literature is inspired by the Sanskrit and Prakrit and very often, by the way, Sogdian and all sorts of sources that we don't have. So it's not true that when you have a Sanskrit antecedent or a Sanskrit source which they could have used, that they necessarily have. You see, it's because at the time, you see, it was much more likely that texts would be in various Central Asian languages, of which Sogdian is only one. We have no reason to think that these people translated at this stage in the way that the Tibetans translated from the Sanskrit. Because the Tibetans, they would simply calc, they would produce something in Tibetan, you know, that you could translate back into Sanskrit convincingly, right? That was not possible with these stories, you see, typically. That's interesting. So the Chinese were worse at it. Indeed, as far as philosophy is concerned, the Chinese were never as good at Buddhist philosophy as the Tibetans, and were a miserable failure by comparison. And that's interesting, you know, because the Tibetans have maintained a solid grasp of the essence of Indian logic, for example, throughout the centuries, whereas in China, that solid grasp was achieved under Xuanzang, and lost after his disciples, and by the time you were in 900 AD, they didn't. They wrote only nonsense under the title of Yinming. I mean, you know, they lost it. And the person who then recaptured it was first Liu Cheng in the 20th century. That's interesting. Whereas in Tibet, you know, you would have had these guys, you know, who were solidly interesting on this Nyaya logic. So they simply, they beat it. They got it. Why? Because they were bilingual and the Chinese were by and large non-bilingual. Translation of Buddhist texts was like the telephone game. You see, somebody said it and then you see, and then in the end, and then comes the translation. Well, that's not the same as you have, shall we say, in Europe, when translation from Latin was for a public, half of whom could read Latin and would tell you, what is this? You see? And so much more critical. You see what I mean? In China, the situation was that bilinguals were very rare, and that translation was for non-bilinguals, and there was no risk of being called, for being criticized and so on. So it's very different. Does that answer your...
Oh, yeah, yeah. Right.
So now the thing that interests me is this colloquial narrative, indigenous Chinese, the Chinese novel, and so on. It's all very fine. And you have this beginning from circa 400 onwards, and you have a masterful survey of the language of these productions by Jiang Shaoyu, who is the co-editor of our TLS and the head of the section for classical Chinese in Peking University. So that is absolutely the authoritative summary. If I wanted to give you the bibliography on this narrative and table talk language, probably it would take about 50 pages of bibliography to introduce it to you. It's very popular, it's very interesting, and it is, of course, a description of the origins of modern Mandarin Chinese, if you see what I mean. So it's all very exciting. I hope you can see that this is something where you feel you are getting close to Mandarin Chinese and so on, and therefore people are very interested. I remind you that all the sources they here discuss are full of those Ji Cheng Xing De traditionalisms. So when, for example, you are told that San Guo Zhi Yan Yi is a Baihua novel, oh well. Or when somebody says that Shui Hu Zhuan is a Baihua novel, well. See, lots of whole paragraphs, you see, can actually turn into classical Chinese and so on, and that is part of the joy of colloquial Chinese at the time, that it could do this Martin Luther, you see, that it could code switch. So code switching is an integral part of colloquial Chinese, and it is very unfortunate that this code switching is not discussed even in by Jiang Shaoyu here, you see, because they only want to see the colloquialisms, you see. But of course I think it's very important to study the way in which the tradition remains alive in the innovation. And that is something which is much in evidence throughout the colloquial narrative and table talk. When I say table talk, I refer to such things as Zhu Xi, Zhu Zi Yu Lei. The table talk of Zhu Xi, the philosopher, Neo-Confucian philosopher, who actually did sometimes also veer into very lively reports of what he has seen and his prejudices and so on in the latter part of his Zhu Zi Yu Lei. The first part is rather Ku Zhao De, like Xun Gu Xue. It's philology in a traditional sense, but the later part of this is actually very informal. And of course, Zhu Xi was very much like Martin Luther, of opinion that it was great fun to explain the traditional in colloquial Chinese. And therefore, the Zhu Zi Yu Lei would be one of the major sources we have on intellectual discourse in the vernacular, in the colloquial Chinese. It is, you can read many places that the colloquial was not used in books on serious subjects. That is a lie, because Chen Chun wrote his famous dictionary of Neo-Confucian vocabulary, a Chinese conceptual history, in colloquial Chinese. So at this time, under the influence of Zhu Xi, it became actually possible to write a whole book in colloquial Chinese on a philosophical subject. It's quite extraordinary. And especially since you have to understand, Zhu Zi Yu Lei would be a book which purports to describe the discourse by Zhu Xi, so it reports speech. But the dictionary by Chen Chun does not pretend any such thing. Do we have it? It's really written in colloquial Chinese. I think it's quite interesting. So we have it. And then we have the primers of vernacular Chinese. These are the people who are worth their weight in gold, you see, because they went to the harbor cities of China, you know, and they simply listened to what people were saying, and then they wrote grammars for their Korean compatriots, helping their compatriots how to communicate with the man in the street. And on these we have a terrific source. Svetlana Rimsky-Korsakov, who, by the way, is not a daughter. No, no, she's related. She's related, but she's not. She's not a daughter or something. She's related to them. Anyway, she wrote this grammatical analysis of the Lao Tzu Da with an English translation of the Chinese text. Terrific. 560 pages. Beautiful thing. I wish I had a PDF, I don't. And that, of course, gives you real access to Kou Tou Hua, right? This is Xiang Tu Kou Yu, right? And completely uninterested in the Gu Dian Bai Hua that we were talking about before. When we are talking about narrative literature in the colloquial style, basically what we are saying is Wudian, classical, Bai Hua. That's very different from Kou Tou Hua, you know. And here we have, if you're interested, I have a whole folder with these texts, and I'm delighted to distribute it to many who wants to have them. They are beautiful evidence, and evidence, of course, which shows that what many grammar or histories of the Chinese language and so on describe as spoken Chinese was nothing of the kind. See, was still stylized, Gudian, you see, classical, Bai Hua, not at all the thing. And even Jinping Mei would not represent really this level of Zude, you see. So these are real treasures, these materials written for foreigners. And they were written for foreigners who didn't want to speak like Shui Hu Duan, you see, which to the man in the street sounds like a very pretentious, you know, a pompous way of talking. And so they needed a primer in this simple language. You will see that we have a little bit of this effect again in the 19th century when foreign missionaries in large numbers needed to be instructed in communicating with people speaking southern dialects and so on, and we have these splendid grammatical descriptions of Chinese dialects, which are by far the earliest that we have in China. The Chinese themselves would never have thought it worth describing. So these foreign productions can be very important registrations. So, for example, the Bible translations into southern dialects and so on are precious evidence on early speech. So there we are. Grammars of modern standard Chinese in English. One thing that if you are serious about studying Chinese at all, then the book Grammar of Spoken Chinese by Y.R. Zhao is a must. It is a must because he was a terrific logician and he was extremely observant about his own language and that of his deviant wife, which he also reports on. It is extremely readable and highly intelligent throughout. You could recommend that to your grandmother, you know, as an example of why it is fun to study Chinese. He really has given us the finest. And in fact, it has been translated by the greatest Taiwanese linguist, Ding Bang Xin, into Taiwanese Chinese, and by Lu Shuxiang into Peking Chinese, and everybody agrees Zhao Yanren is the greatest. And of course, Zhao Yanren also could speak Chinese backwards. He could. So he could speak Mandarin Chinese backwards, you know. He wouldn't say ta, but he would say at, and so on. And then if you played the other way around, you know, it was quite correct. So he could speak Chinese backwards. And he learned it because somebody had given him a tape the wrong way, you know. So he learned it. You know, that was fixed the wrong way, and so he could read back. And he found that fascinating. And I don't think anybody else has achieved this.
I think it was his daughter didn't she coin the term pot sticker and stir fry when she wrote her famous cuisine?
Yeah.
I think it was his daughter.
It was his daughter. Anyway, the man was extremely lively, supremely confident, and something of a Hua Hua Gongzi, I'm afraid. and his great contribution to the science of linguistics was that he translated Alice in Wonderland into Chinese in a philosophical spirit. He was wondering how much of it could actually be transported. That is that work, 1926, he wrote that. It's a classic and is still being sold everywhere in China. It's a very remarkable study. I have had a student wrote her thesis on this. One of my students wrote a thesis on this translation of Alice in Wonderland. It's remarkable. So this is the book, as far as I'm concerned, you know, where you get the excitement. And you can also have Mandarin Chinese, a functional reference grammar by 1989, which is full of non-Chinese sentences and shows something of the development of Chinese linguistics in our century. A giant leap backwards, as far as I'm concerned. But you can, of course, see it has all the references and so on. It's a learned book. But quite boring and full of mistakes. And then you have Jim Huang from Harvard, The Syntax of Chinese, which is only for those who are dedicated to theory, because it is completely unreadable for anybody. I think. Yes, and it's also full of, it is full of howlers, I mean. It's remarkable. So this is my best illustration. These are the most influential grammars, and I am convinced that very few of our colleagues would disagree, you know, that there is a straight line down, you know. It's got worse and worse, as far as I'm concerned. So I really don't think you would become much wiser as a student by reading these news things. You should read Waiyao Zhao, and then a very short book by Lu Shuxiang, you know, Xian Dai Han Yu, Yu Fa Fen Xi Wen Ti. It's 40 pages. It has everything. It is very, very beautiful. Lu Shuxiang is my enshi in China. He wrote the title page for my thesis in 1981. And I think he was, of course, chosen by Mao Zedong as the Pope of linguistics in China, and turned out to be a huge success. You will be always well advised to read Lu Shuxiang, who any time would say that Waiyao Zhao was the great man and he was nothing, but he wrote beautifully on Chinese grammar also, Lu Shuxiang. The number of books, of course, on modern Chinese grammar is infinite, and I won't want to summarize the Chinese ones. My personal hero, since there's so many here who might be clued up on this, I would remind you that probably, in my judgment, probably the finest living specialist is Xinfui from Wuhan. Sanbai, it's a fantastic book. And Xinfui, I think, is the most incisive observer of modern Chinese that I have met. And I'm very sorry because I'm not even Dian Zhijiaoshou in his university. I'm in the competing university of Wuhan. I am Tianzhi, but not in his university. But I still find he is the greatest, Xinfui. And then you have, of course, Lu Jianming, who is very fine in Beida, and very systematic, and in fact, more systematic than Xinfui. The only reason why I would recommend Xinfui to your attention is that his observations are really incredibly sharp, and he is very readable, and not so system. I mean, I once met him, by the way. When I first met him, I accused him of being a linguistic anarchist, and he said, you have it. He loves it, you see. He loves to see an example that shouldn't exist. And I love that kind of linguistics, you see, where you face these things, you see, that shouldn't be said, and so on, and you wonder. And that's, I think, how we learn more about language. So I think Xinfui is good. I think we have it. If you like, you know, we can talk more about modern Chinese grammars. It's infinite. There are certainly no good ones that I would recommend recently produced. So now we have an important issue. We are wise cracking about Chinese grammar, and we'll be doing this all this term. But I would like to recommend to you your attention that not only do we have all these modern style, Western and mostly American inspired Chinese linguists who do very well in describing Chinese. We also have the history of indigenous Chinese grammatical analysis. So you want to sort of lean back, you know, and ask how many civilizations do we have that have substantial work along these lines? You know, very few. You have, of course, the Indian, very much. You have the Greek Latin, very much. And that's about it, because the Arabs took it all from the Greeks and so on. Yes.
What do you make of the Japanese tradition? Is it just Chinese transplanted onto Japanese soil, or they? I know nothing about it. That's why I'm asking. I know that they have something.
Yes.
Which is very native and very non-Western.
Yeah.
I just don't know where it comes from.
It's an interesting question. Perhaps we should take it up again when I've thought more about it and looked more at things. It's an interesting question. Of course, their lexicography and their phonology and so on, you see, are all heavily inspired by the Chinese, but How exactly did the transportation of the Sanskrit tradition to Japan take place? You see, because that's what we are talking about. This will be an influence through the Buddhist tradition from India. So I'm not going to talk more about it, but that is clearly the way it will have evolved. The details I'd like to discuss when I've worked more on it, you know, I haven't. To my mind, creative in terms of grammatical analysis have only been these three traditions, and the Koreans, for example, also not, and so on. So it's interesting. One would love to learn about a new culture that also did it, you know, but you need to see the evidence.
Yeah. Sorry, which three?
What?
Sorry, which three were
the? The, you know, the Greco-Roman, which spread, which basically spread to America and infested the whole world. And, you know, it's called scientific, you see, which I think is a very interesting phenomenon that you can get that kind of a situation, you know, where we, you know, the colonialists celebrate their higher awareness by calling it the science, you see. And then you have, of course, the Indian, which is much superior, earlier, and much more sophisticated, and a real hammer, Paranini, and so on. You see, and also the tradition that followed, you know, this is not at all just one Paranini, you know, you had these real freaks, grammar freaks, you see, and by the way, poetics freaks and rhetoric freaks in India, you know. So this Indian tradition is an immensely interesting and powerful development, which is not being acknowledged as much as it deserves, as I see it, especially in the history of rhetoric and poetics and so on. They are. They should have been much more prominent in our vision of what scientific rhetoric is, you see. But of course, we just think Quintilian is it, you see? Because Quintilian is what via Germany came to America. But I don't think, if you see what I mean, I don't think that that is a very well argued position to take on rhetoric and poetics and so on. And then, thirdly, you see, you have this philological tradition in China, right? And I think it has signal weaknesses vis-à-vis les Indiens, and that is why they would take from India, for example, much of their inspiration in phonology, and so on. And they recognized the superiority of their methods by voting for the Indians by their feet, with their feet, you see, taking over these things. So it's interesting. Then beyond this, the best way to put it is that old Christoph didn't know about any fourth, if you see what I mean, has yet to be convinced that there was a fourth. You can talk about the Arabic tradition, but it is throughout where I've checked this closely, which I have on occasion done, for example, for the transmission of Aristotle and so on, you see, it is very difficult to see an independent analytic tradition in the Arabic context, I believe, also for grammar. But I'm quite ready to learn something new, and very obviously, in the case of Arabic, they had to apply what they learned from the Greek grammarians and from the Stoic logicians and so on. They had to apply that to a completely new language style and so on, and therefore will have been original in that sense. Mm-hmm. But to my mind, they will have to be said to have been an offshoot of the Greek tradition, just as the Germans were and so on. So that it makes no sense to speak of an independent German tradition there. Similarly for the Koreans and the Vietnamese and so on. So I hope you have the, by the way, when are we supposed to stop?
4:20.
What, 4:30?
4:20.
4:20, right, all right. So I think this is very good. Some of us will be very glad get out of here. The history of indigenous analysis, there is a man called Sun Yangming, a terrific man who spent his whole life studying the articulation of semantic and syntactic analysis in Chinese commentaries since the 3rd century BC. And at some point, when I met him, he sent me all his papers. He wrote an enormous one. And then he has summarized his wisdom in a book which I could give you. This is the book, you know, 古代汉语语法变化研究. This is a rare thing. I think in China, Sun Yangming is a true hero. He's the only one who has persistently documented the Chinese perceptions of their own language and these subjectivities of each civilization vis-à-vis leur propre civilisation is, I think, very much worth putting a lot of emphasis on, you see, because these are precious observations of the people, and they are observing their own linguistic intuitions, you see. And so we're not imposing our categories or our ways of looking on them when we study this in detail. One of the things that he notices, for example, is what we describe as a change in semantics from verb noun, you see? For example, Wang, king, Wang, rule as king, right? That's what everybody says. But you find when you look at Chinese perceptions, that they understood very clearly the distinction is not at all one of word class. It is of agent versus action. But as you can see in the word action, not every action is a verb. Witness the word action. You see, and you can see the stupidity of the Western approach, you see, which absolutely has to have their goddamn. You see what I mean? You know, they must have their categories imposed. You see, they got decent verbs and so on. No, it's see, the language works differently. And these perceptions that they have themselves show very clearly that they could distinguish between saying that something is a verb, you see, and that something describes an action. Because lots of nominalizations, you see, describe actions but are nouns and so on, you see, but this is a completely different game. Confusing these things is what happens to you when you don't read closely enough the Chinese Xun Gu Xue. And that Xun Gu Xue is summarized for all of us by the great hero of Xun Gu Xue, my great hero Zong Fu Bang of Wuhan Da Xue, who wrote his Gu Xun Hui Zuan, where he collects these ancient glosses. And that collection of ancient glosses, of course, is the Bible for Professor Sun Yangming. So basically, what I'm telling you is, it is the ancient glosses which the Chinese produced on their own works which give us this subjectivity on their own language, which is so precious. And this subjectivity is summarized in this book by Zong Fu Bang. Zong Jiao de Zong, Fu Qi de Fu, Liu Bang de Bang, Zong Fu Bang, Hui Zuan, you will see it. It's a terrific book. And I have myself written on this in my book, Language and Logic, which is volume 7 of Science and Civilization in China. And there I have explained the history of these matters. I hope that you, in the course of these lectures, you will see how the joys of historical grammar ultimately are the joys of taking seriously the indigenous reactions to their own material, taking seriously the Xun Gu tradition, you see? and making logical sense of it. And not just generalize troubled war, you see, but trying to make logical sense. I hope you can, you will find that amusing. So now we have the question, has anybody done a historical grammar of Chinese? Indeed. Or Tatatsuo, historical grammar of Chinese, 中国语历史文法, translated by my very dear friend Jiang Shaoyu into Chinese with some improvements, I believe, and annotations and so on. Excellent. That is the classic. It's got terrific. It has got terrific indices and so on. So you can look up any phenomenon in the history of the Chinese language and you can look up its evolution here, described by O Ta Tatsuo. He also wrote the Han Yu Shi Tong Kao, the comprehensive studies of the history of the Chinese language, which are his supplementary studies and so on. These two books are all available. You'll find them easily available as PDF and so on. But these are the masterful handbooks, you see, the survey. And one of the students of Zhu Deci, the great linguist at Peking University, co-students of Li Shuxiang, Sun Qixin, actually is a student of Li Shuxiang, together with Zhu Deci, and he worked with TLS, and his great work is the Han Yu Li Shi Yu Fa Yao Yue. That is very charming and a very nice alternative interpretation. You can look up any construction, and so on. But it's a Chinese work, it's not Japanese, so the indices are not as good as those of the Japanese. That's my prejudice. I find that reconfirmed every time I open a new Japanese book. You know, they're very careful with their documentation. And then you have the rather philosophically minded Shi Zongzhi, very nice man, Han Yu Yu Fa Shi Gang Yao. These are the kinds of books that you can easily find also in PDF on the web everywhere. And they are the sort of thing you can have in the back of your mind as you follow this course. In Western language, again, the only text that is usable is the Drevni Kitayski Yazyk Teksty Grammatika Leksicheski Komentari. A 1978 fat book, and it simply is, can you imagine, a historical anthology where it starts from Jiaguwen and ends in Xiandai Hanyu, and in each case it gives you selections and then annotates them carefully linguistically. So it's perfect for our purposes. And probably the best we would be able to do is to translate this into English. And then we would begin to be able to teach students of sinology with a proper sense of the history of their linguistic material. So it's interesting. We have that Russian handbook. You can imagine for each section he would go through all the, this is also by Krukov, and he would go through all the linguistic features and innovations and special phenomena for each period. And therefore, I think in a way, for learning about the history of the Chinese language, this book is more attractive than a general grammar because you have texts that are nicely chosen, interesting to read, and then you can on the occasion of these texts, learn about the grammatical change. So, finally, we have bibliography. You see, I have only given you the kind of highlights and so on. You might want to have the bibliography of articles on ancient Chinese grammar. 172 pages plus 40 pages indices. Fine print. I can assure you, you know, there's not going to be a shortage of things to read about the history of the Chinese language. But that is Sun Liping. Practically all these contributions are available online, most conveniently through CrossAsia. So if you are interested in working seriously on this, you must get this password for CrossAsia. I think you probably have it through Chicago, probably.
CrossAsia?
Yeah, it's a fantastic thing. I thought it had to be criminal, but apparently it isn't, because everything is there for downloading, you know. It's amazing. If you can ever get into CrossAsia, you have made it, I can tell you. It's amazing. And it is apparently perfectly legal. It is an open thing.
Is it only on Chinese language
or
other Asian languages?
Other yeah. But it's unreal. I mean, if you get into the detail, you know, the access. This is organized by a very clever German bibliographer in Berlin, you know, who simply has a sort of mafioso skills and simply got this access to all these things that shouldn't be free access, you know. So I strongly recommend this as long as it lasts. But I think it's entirely legal, you know, it is fine. it's just extraordinarily rich. So apart from that, if you don't mind, Alain Lucas, Linguistique Chinoise, Bibliographie, that series, Linguistique Chinoise, has continued for many years in Paris and is the kind of bibliographic branch of the CRLAO of the French Paris School of Historical Linguistics. So these Linguistique Chinoise, these include reviews of most things. So it's quite an asset. Especially if you begin to study this, you know, this kind of thing, you know, you just find where it is in your library, I'm sure you have it, and you just leaf through and look at the reviews. So that's the bibliography, and we are almost done. I'm sorry to have to quickly tell you a little bit about digitized resources. Mm-hmm. Basically, we have all Chinese literature collected by the Chinese emperor available as the Sikhu Quanshu, the four division complete book. That is completely digitized and beautifully available in many kinds of editions. So we simply have, at one go, under our noses, everything published until, you know, officially published as part of the mainstream literature until 1783. We have complete the Buddhist Tripitaka, the collection of Buddhist texts. We have all these available in beautiful digitized editions. We have all the subculture of Taoism, so the Daozang of the 15th century. That is also by now available in poor quality but in digitized form. And we also have about 500 novels from the 15th down to the early 20th century, also available beautifully under, you look up Kaifang, on the Kaifang. I can give you the email address, so internet address. So you have all this material accessible. I think we have what in French is called embarras de richesse. You see, we have far too much that we could be looking at, and I'm damned, I will not allow us to drown in this secondary literature and this superabundance of facts. You see, on the contrary, what I will do shamelessly is to spend the rest of this course discussing with you individual examples and their interpretation and what we can learn from them. So it's going to be, in all cases, examples that are transcribed with literal glosses, mot à mot, and with an analysis, and we want to discuss what to learn from these examples. Because I think anything that would go beyond this kind of first training with hands-on study of sentences and what do we learn from these sentences on the nature of human language on the one hand and on the nature of the development of the Chinese language on the other hand. So we will begin by looking at examples from modern Chinese and show how history pops up in modern Chinese. And also, of course, how modern Chinese has some systematic features that deserve our attention. So I think you don't need to be afraid that we will continue in this vein of inundating you with info on books and texts and so on. On the contrary, I think we will want to engage in an informal discussion of those examples. We have now about 8 minutes to for any questions or suggestions.
Will the examples be Romanized?
Yes. Everything is Romanized. And here I would like to give you an example. In Chinese linguistics, Romanizing is pervasively confused with transcribing. You see, Romanization into pinyin I will give, you see, but what of course any decent dictionary of Chinese should give is IPA transcription. And it is one of the grave confusions of Chinese lexicography that these IPA transcriptions are missing in all dictionaries of Mandarin Chinese that I know. I have only a couple of hundred, but there are 3,000, and all of them think that you specify the pronunciation of a word by writing the by writing the orthography. That's absurd. So they write E-D-N-R, you see, and so on. And of course, as far as I'm concerned, they completely distort the nature of tones, because it's not true that the sequence of sounds is invariant under tones. So, for example, you say shao, is it, to burn, shao, but you say hao, you see, no hao, you see, which is hao, you see, he was Cantonese, the man. He was Cantonese, I swear to you. So, can you see, shao, and you can't say shao, no, shao, you see, you get a, so now, just, to show you my interest in these matters. If you have a dictionary that doesn't even tell you this difference between the first tone pronunciation, you see, and the third tone pronunciation, you see, then you have a foul dictionary. You see, that is to say, it distorts the situation, which in fact I think in teaching Chinese is commonly distorted, as if You have the same sounds, you see, and then different tones as suprasegmental features of those, you see, which is completely wrong.
And not to mention the fact that using the pinyin transcription sort of inscribes a certain bhonghwa nature to the transcription as well.
Also, yes. But I'm interested, actually, you know, I would any good or bad transcription, if it is this kind of orthography, is foul. It stinks. You see, because it fails to note down the differences in the vowel qualities. Give you another example. If you say Shanghai, you see, go on the sea, right? Mm-hmm. That I is very much ah, right? But if you look carefully at the way people say Shanghai, you see, mm-hmm. you have a schwaization, you see, that is a reduction of the specificity of the ah, which is interesting, you know. And if people don't allow me to note these kinds of things, you know, then I would like to do something other than Chinese linguistics, if you see what I mean, you know. It's ridiculous. You know, these are the joys of doing it properly, you know. And you can tell why in studying Chinese you should pay attention to this business of Shanghai, for example. Why? Because good research is very much a show of sensitivity, to have an ear for these nuances, you see? So this is just one example. This is typical, you see? But you just have to face it, and the fact that everybody denies you see, these kinds of phenomena should not prevent us, you know, from standing up, being counted, you know, that this way of pretending that to write out the pinyin is to specify a pronunciation, you know, does great damage to the learning of Chinese. That's what I would want to claim. And if we, for example, in French and so on, you know, you have you have the orthography on the one hand, and then on the other, you have IPA transcription. This is only one example, and if you like, my hope in this class is to give you some kind of sensitivity training vis-à-vis la langue, right? You know, to let you, you know, become more observant, you see, and to become together in this analysis more observant in regard to nuances which very often in our literature, you know, are going to be absent, in fact. So, thank you very much. That was it. See you next week.